praise the Lord. We're here for another healing school. Amen. And God's going to do some wonderful things. We'll pray and then we'll get right into the Word of God. Father, we thank you today, Lord, for this opportunity that we have to share the Word of God concerning our health and these steps that we can take to see this come to pass in our life. And Father, I thank you for everyone that is here today. We thank you for all that are watching online. We're grateful. And Lord, we know that according to your word in Isaiah 55:11, that it will not return void, but it shall accomplish the thing that you have sent it to do. And Lord, we're grateful and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we want to continue today on this subject of the Bible's secret of words. And this is the third week that we've been looking at this. And we'll recap briefly some things that we've said over the past few weeks. And one thing that we have said consistently is simply this, that I do not have a choice as to whether or not I live by words, but I do have a choice as to what words I live by. The Lord shared that with me some years ago, and because very often what will happen, I was visiting with a minister one time, and this was a minister, and when I say what he said, you're going to think, well, he was a minister? Yeah, he was a minister. And I was visiting with him, and we were talking along these lines about confession, about saying what you desire and receiving. Jesus said you can have what you say. And he made this statement to me. He said, well, you know, that confession business, that just sounds like legalism to me. And, well, the issue is, he just didn't want to discipline himself to say what the Word of God said about the situation. Either that, or he just did not want to push into that level of believing God. See, I don't have a choice as to whether or not I live by words. The Word of God declares, Jesus said, I'll have what I say. Period. Death and life. The book of Proverbs says death and life are in the power of my tongue. And that word power means, it in the Hebrew, it means the hand of my tongue. And it didn't say either or. The word didn't say either death or life are in the power of your tongue. It said death and life are in the power of your tongue or in the hand of your tongue. And so that is the essence of this, is that every day I am procuring, bringing into my life death, or I'm bringing life. And it's largely, I say largely just for the sake of the possibility, but largely because of the words I speak, all right? Jesus said something, Matthew 8:13 is where we'll look, and we'll recap. This is part of our recap as well. When he healed the centurion's servant, Jesus made a statement to him, the centurion, in verse 13. He said to the centurion, go your way, and as you have believed, so be it done to you. And his servant was healed in the selfsame hour. Now notice what Jesus said. He said, as you have believed. He did not say it would work if you believed right. He said, whether you believe right or wrong is still the law. As you have believed. All right? That's the essence of this whole teaching, is what I say is what I believe. Jesus said, out of the abundance of your heart, the mouth speaks. All right? I've talked with people before, counseling in different situations, marriage and other circumstances, and one of the two parties would say, well, you know, I mean, I said that, but I really didn't mean that. Well, you can't do that. You can't say what you don't mean, because Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Now, I know that every person, maybe even sitting here today and watching online, that we think that we say things we don't mean or that we don't believe, but the Word of God says we don't. If I walk outside and it's 95 degrees and I say, whew, it is hot, I believe that. I just simply believe that. If I walk out in a 95 degree day and I go, whoo, it's cold, somebody's going to think I'm a nut, all right? Because there's just no factual evidence to back up what I said, all right? Now, but here's the point. Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And very often when I'm under pressure, I am pushing into healing. I'm pushing into victory in my physical body. Very often that's the pressure that reveals what's in my heart, because that's what comes out of my mouth. Amen. And so we say what we believe, and the problem with that is this. We usually believe what we see. And so we say what we see, and then we're confined to what we see. Usually people believe what they see, so they say what they see, and then they're confined to what they see. And so that's why I don't have a choice as to whether or not I live by words, but I have a choice as to what words I live by. You know, it's just a mindset of moving away, and we're going to get into the scripture about this, but thinking in line with the Word of God. What does the Word of God say concerning this circumstance, concerning my healing? And then lining my speech up with what the Word of God says, all right? Because the Apostle Paul said there are many voices in the world, and he said none of them are without significance, all right? None of them are without significance. There are no non-important words. All right, they're all important in any area of our lives, but especially when we're dealing with the area of our healing. All right, so Genesis chapter 1 is where we'll begin today. And we want to look at how does God use words? How does God use His words? And in Genesis chapter 1, God uses words to call things that are not as though they were. Now, He uses that concept from the very beginning. All right? And He doesn't say, God does not call things like they aren't. He calls things as though they were. All right? In other words, God doesn't look at a situation where a person is dealing with sickness and say that person's not sick. God calls that person healed. He doesn't deny what is. He calls for what isn't. He calls for what isn't. And this is where if a person's not careful, they can miss it, where their words, confession, whatever you want to say, is concerned, because they'll look and say, well, I'm not sick. Well, that's the desire, is not to be sick, but the issue is I'm dealing with this right now. And so I've got to call for what I want, all right? When you walk into a room, if you walk into your home or wherever it may be, and it's 85 degrees in that room and you want it to be 70, well, you have to go over to that thermostat and you have to move it down to 70. Well, you're not denying that it's 85 degrees in that room. You're saying it's 85 degrees and this is what I want. So then you call for something else. Hallelujah. And so when I am dealing with an issue in my body, dealing with circumstances in our health, I don't go and say, I'm not sick, I don't have this. I begin to call for what I want. That's how God has done things from the very beginning. In Genesis chapter 1, verse 3, it says, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. Or God said, light be, and light was. And then verse 4 says, and God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. So verse 3 says, and God says, and God said, verse 4 says, and God saw. The point is this: God said, and then He saw what He said. God said, light be, verse 4, and God saw the light. Now, immediately, people will say, but you know, Pastor Steele, that's God. I understand, but that is our example. This is my example, all right? God wanted light. He didn't step out there and say, it's not dark, it's not dark, it's not dark. He called for what he wanted. He called for light. He said, light be in this situation. And then he saw the light. The light was. Hallelujah. Now, obviously, that happened instantaneously. It happened immediately when God said that. And there's a number of reasons for that. But the primary reason for that is God never doubts his own word. God never doubts what's coming out of his mouth. God is a man of integrity, a person of integrity. If we can use that, you know, we understand God's not a man. But God is an individual of integrity. And he said it, and then verse 4 says God saw it. So the point is God said, and then he saw what he said. Then in verse 5, it says, and God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day. The center column reference of my Bible says, and the evening was, and the morning was. The evening was, and the morning was. The point is this. God said it, and it was just like God said it was. He separated. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. So when God called the light day, the morning was, and then the evening was. It wasn't that way. It became that way when God called it that way. The light and the dark were not separated until God called it that way. So my healing will begin to manifest more quickly and more readily when I begin to call myself what the Word says. Hallelujah. Because the issue is what makes it difficult at times to call things and to talk, if we want to use the phrase correctly, is because in physical issues, what is going on is so noticeable. It's so readily seeable. All right, in most issues. If somebody's diagnosed with a grave illness and they begin to lose weight, it's evident that that illness is working. And so what I've got to overcome immediately is the look of sickness on myself or on that person. And I've got to begin to call for something else. Hallelujah. Well, this is the report. Well, I understand that that's the report, but understand this, I'm calling something else. That's not just keeping a good thought. That's not just keeping a good confession. Words are more than negative and positive. Words are life and death. Words are carriers. Words carry my faith, and they carry my faith into my circumstance. Faith is born of the words I speak. Doubt is born of the words that I speak. And so when we had a dear family in our church that went through a very trying time back the last part of last year. As a matter of fact, the young lady, they still come to church here, and the young lady had went in. She had what they called, what it ultimately became was stretching of the heart. And her heart was retaining fluid, and it stretched. And it stretched up on the scale, it stretched to 899. Well, I mean, that's terminal. I mean, and she died. She died in the emergency room. She fell out in her husband's arms. And he began to pray for her and slap her face, say, no, you come back to me in Jesus' name. And she did. Now, the doctor said that. We're not just saying that she did that. That's what the doctor said happened. Well, anyway, I went up to, obviously, to visit them in the hospital. And they're people of faith. They've been with us for a number of years. But I still had to find out where they were. Okay, what are you guys standing on? What scriptures are we standing on? Where are we at? And I made this statement. Now, I'm just telling you I said this because I said it. And I made this statement. I said, okay, what are we believing for? See, when you're in a situation, you've got to know what you're believing for. It can't be haphazard. Well, I just want to be healed. Wait a minute. That's a desire, but how do you attach faith to that? Well, I just want to feel better. Well, that's wonderful, and that'll be a product of the healing, but just wanting to feel better is not enough. Because, you understand, I've got to call for something, and how do I call for feel better? I can't do that, because the feeling better comes with healing. I don't feel better unless I get healed. So I've got to call for something. Well, here's the point that I'm making. And so I was talking to them, and I said, so what are we believing for? And they began to tell me what we were believing for and what they were believing for. And I made this statement. I said, all right, then every person that comes in this room, when they walk in the room, you look at them and you open your mouth and you say, this is what we're believing for. This is what we're calling. And we will not tolerate any words to the contrary of that. And if that's a problem, then we love you, but we don't need you to visit us. Why? This is life and death. This is life and death. This is an illness that the doctor said could be terminal very quickly. So we can't play with this. We got to be calling the right thing all the time. Amen. Now, no matter what you're dealing with, no matter what you're dealing with online, if you're dealing with it, all right, you're here because you'd want to not have to deal with it anymore. Then you've got to consistently call for what you want. God looked at the darkness. For whatever reason, the darkness was there. It doesn't matter why the darkness was there. God saw darkness and called light. It doesn't matter why the sickness is in your body. We know that the devil's the author of it, and we understand that. It doesn't matter how it was contracted. It doesn't matter how it came on you. The issue is, let's start calling now for the victory in that situation. And it doesn't matter why it happened or why it came on you. The fact is, the Word of God will get it off of you. Amen. Hallelujah. And so, anyway, they just kept this going. And the Lord gave me a scripture for them. And it's in the Word of God. It was, our heart does safely trust in the Lord. And in the book of Jeremiah, He will bring them health and cure. And so those were some of the things we were standing on. Well, I got the report, still have the report in my desk. So from the time this started, there was on their scale, it was an 899. And the Word of God continued to work. And we've seen that number drop. And the last time that she went to the doctor and they did the stretch test, it was at a 40. So it went from 899 to 40. All right. Now, here's what the doctor said. He said, now, I'm going to stop short of calling you cured. He said, but you're right where we want you to be. Well, they're still on medicine. And that's another thing. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Don't get under condemnation about taking medicine. Don't get under condemnation about doing what the doctor tells you to do. Doing what the doctor tells you to do is not agreeing with what the doctor's saying. Whatever it may be. Amen. Because that's just how it is. I've been to the doctor before, and the doctor has said things to me before. Well, I didn't have to agree with it. I could call for something else. All right? But the issue is so there's still medicine there, but even that is about to change. That's subject to change. Why? Because we're calling for total and complete healing. We're calling for 100% wholeness and soundness in that circumstance. So God said He saw the darkness, but He called for light, and the light was. And then He called the light day, and the darkness He called night, or the morning and the evening was. They weren't when he called them. But when He called them, they were. Hallelujah. So it wasn't that way when God said it, but when He said it, then it was. All right? Now, in Genesis 13, verse 14, It says, the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up now your eyes and look from the north where you are, northward, or look to the place where you are, northward and southward and eastward and westward. For all the land that you see, to you will I give it, and to your seed forever. And I will make your seed as the dust of the earth. So if a man can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed also be numbered. Hallelujah. Now, here we see God operating this same principle that he used in Genesis chapter 1. Calling what is not as though it is. Now, there seems to be a part of this principle missing, though. And the part that seems to be missing is God said it, but then we don't see any children for Abraham. He said it, but we don't see anything. He said it, but we don't see it. Well, it may look like that to us, but to God, when God says something, it is done. It's completed. Now, almost every person in church, if you ask them, can God lie? No, Pastor. Will God lie? Absolutely not. He said, I'm the Lord that heals you. Now, why do people have a hard time with that? Because we've been taught that sometimes God does and sometimes God doesn't. We've been taught that he might heal you, he might not. We don't know. You can't understand God's ways. You know, you never know what God might do. Well, what do you think is going to come out of that person's mouth that was taught that? When they face a physical battle, they're going to go to God and say, Lord, if it be your will, if it's your will to heal me, thank you for healing me. God can't answer that prayer because it's always his will, but the person's not sure of his will. I've got to be sure of God's will in the circumstance. That's the way I know what to call for. If I don't know what God wants, I don't know what to call for. And so, when God says something, it's done. Why? Well, because of what we said earlier, God cannot lie. When God says something, it's truth. And it's automatically settled in heaven. And that's why healing is not a promise that God will do something. Healing is a promise that God's already done something. It's a settled fact. It's a settled issue. God heals me. Hallelujah. Now, when God said, I will multiply your seed, Abraham didn't see it. But God did. Well, why did God see it? Because he said it. Because he said it. When God says it, he sees it. That's why God can look at you and call you things that you don't understand how he can be calling you that. When he came to Gideon and he said, the angel of the Lord told Gideon, he said, Hail, mighty man of valor. And Gideon said, Me? He couldn't see what God was seeing. He had no concept of that. When Jeremiah said, Lord, I can't speak, I'm just a child. God said, don't say you're a child. Go speak and I'll fill your mouth. Don't say you're a child. I've called you. I've ordained you a prophet. See, God was seeing something and God called what they didn't see. See, it's not God calling what is not to him. It's God calling what is not to us. So when I say I'm the healed of the Lord, when I say my body is strong, when I say my heart is strong, when I say my muscles are strong, my tendons are strong, my eyes are good, my ears are good, my mind is good, when I say those things, in some instances, it may be even going contrary to the evidence that is before me, but I'm doing and I'm imitating my Father by calling those things that be not as though they were. Hallelujah. Amen. And you'll hear it all the time. You'll hear people all the time. They'll say things like, "Oh, my memory's shot. I can't remember nothing. I'd forget my head if it wasn't screwed on." Well, see, you know, and people around them, ha, 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 you know, and somebody else will chime in. Yeah, you know how it is. After 40, it's all downhill from there. But that's not what the Bible says. See, I can have what I'm saying. That's what Jesus said. Jesus never used his words in a crooked way. He never said anything he didn't mean. See, that's the issue with us guarding our words. Is I can't be saying things I don't want or things I don't mean. Amen. People come in the house and they'll work hard. And you know, we work hard, people. We all work hard, and I understand that. But people come in and, whew, I'm just wore out. I am wore slap out. I don't have any energy. I don't understand. I'm just wore out. Well, nobody wants to be wore out. Because you know, when you wear out a pair of shoes, you throw them away. When you wear out a pair of pants, you throw them away. But because they're no good anymore. We don't wear out. Our youth is renewed as the eagles, the Bible says. It says, every day his mercies are new every day. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Now, while that can just sound like negative and positive, it's not. As long as you call things that are like they are, they stay the way they are. In order for things to become the way they should be, I've got to call them the way they should be. Hallelujah. When God says something, it's complete. It's done. It's complete. God said it. Now, we say things like, well, God's bringing it to pass. Well, understand, that's true as far as we can see. That's true as far as we can see. But to God, it's done. Because he said it. And the essence of faith is being able to declare God said this, and now I'm walking away with a full belief that it will be just like he said it. I remember my wife and I in the early days of our ministry, we were dealing with some things, and I was reading in the Word about the integrity of God's Word and God being a person of integrity, a man of integrity. And it just came up in my spirit, and I went in the room where my wife was and I said, "Michelle, God can be depended upon to do exactly what he said." Well, my life changed. It was one of those moments that my life changed because something occurred in my spirit that God can be depended upon to do what he said. And if I know that God can be depended upon to do what he said, then trusting what he said is no longer an issue. God said it, so he's going to do it. And so, yes, God is bringing it to pass. There's people watching, people here today. You're in any various stages of this coming to pass and seeing the fruition of it and seeing the completeness of it. But what I don't want to do is stop midstream. God said it, so that's how it's going to be. Now I'm going to keep calling it the way God said it. I'm going to keep calling it the way he said. God uses words for one reason, and that's to bring to pass his desires, to bring to pass his desires. In the book of Psalms, chapter 107, he said concerning healing, he sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. When God desires something for you, he'll speak to you. When God desires it, he'll speak to you. He'll speak to you through his word. He'll speak to you in your spirit. And if we'll get a hold of what he's speaking, we'll see it. But I've got to get a hold of it. The scripture where the word of God says, I will not die but live and declare the works of the Lord. You know, that is so important. Well, why is that so important? Because depending on what you may be dealing with, depending on what somebody's dealing with watching online, there are people that, I know there are people that watch us online that are dealing with terminal issues. And when I say terminal issues, I mean without the word of God, it's something that is terminal. Well, I've got to keep that in my mouth. I will not die, but live. I will not die, but live and declare the works of the Lord. Well, what am I saying? I'm calling those things the way God said it. God said, I will not die, but I will live. And I will declare the works of the Lord. He sent his word and healed them and delivered them of all their destructions. Hallelujah. So when he desires something, he will say it. He will speak it. And if you'll get a hold of what he's speaking, you'll see it. Whatever has been said must be so. If God has said it, it must be so. It must be that way. Now, this is why this is the way you have to think. Because there are multitudes of people that know what God has said about certain things, but it's not so to them. It's not because, now understand what I mean by this. It's not because they don't believe that it's in the Bible, or that they don't believe that what's in the Bible is true. It's just not so to them. They don't have the mindset of God said it, so it has to happen. It has to happen. It's impossible for it not to happen because God said it. Yeah, but it doesn't seem to get any better. Well, see, you're still calling what is as though it is. Call what is as though it, call those things that be not as though they were. Don't call what is as though it is. If God said it, it must be so. And you've got to answer those thoughts. You've got to answer that doubt. And you can't just answer it generically. You've got to answer it specifically. Because make no mistake about this. When you're being bombarded by thoughts in your mind, thoughts about death, thoughts about sickness, thoughts about disease and defeat, that's an attack. That's not just your mind. The devil's helping with that. And that's why I've got to answer, and I've got to answer specifically. No, I will not die, but I will live and declare the works of the Lord. Amen. Back in around 2010, I went through a very trying time, very, very trying time physically. And it was there were physical symptoms, but a lot of it was mental. A lot of it was this attack that I was under. And the enemy kept trying to plague my mind with these thoughts of death and just that this was going to be the end. And you know, I would go to bed at night and see different images, see my funeral, see different things. Well, you know, The thing is this went on for a period of time, but I knew from the very beginning, okay, listen, I've got to answer this specifically every time. I can't just be generic with it. You know, when a thought comes, you need to cast it down, but it's not enough to just say, oh, I cast that thought down in Jesus' name. It's not enough. Why? Because there's an enemy there that's perpetrating that thought, that's trying to get you to think in line with what he's thinking or what he wants you to think. So I had to answer that, and one of those scriptures that I used was that scripture. I will not die, but I will live and declare the works of the Lord. I will not die, but I will live and declare the works of the Lord. I can't tell you how many times I said, I see myself as healed. I see myself strong. The joy of the Lord is my strength. I can do all things through him that strengthens me. My body is well. My mind is well. My heart is well. I'm whole and healed in Jesus' name. And every time those thoughts came, those thoughts had to be answered. They had to be answered verbally. Why? Because they're trying to get me to think something. And here's the thing. What I think is what I'm going to say. And I knew that if I ever gave my speech over to that thing, I'm done. You know, and people will say, do you really think it was that close? I really think it was that close. Amen. And I just had to keep coming. And I had people tell me, they say, Pastor, you came to church all through that, and I didn't even know anything was going on. I didn't even know. Well, that they've said that about other issues. I don't know they specifically said about that, but we just stayed with it. I will not die, but I will live, and I will declare the works of the Lord. And there were other people. There was a man that came to my associate minister, and he asked how I was doing. And he said, well, I believe he's doing good. He said, well, I just was wondering, he said, because I had a dream the other night, and he said, I went to a funeral, and he said, when I got up to the casket, he said it was Pastor Steele. I was at his funeral. And my associate minister, Tony Mendez, he said immediately the Holy Spirit said, don't you tell your pastor that. He don't need to hear that. He's battling this and he don't need to hear that. Well, see, the enemy was talking to other people. He had a plan. I say he had a plan. But here we are 6 years later and his plan didn't work. And it never will work. If you are the establishing witness, your life is going to go the direction of the words that you're speaking. And when I know what the Word of God says, this scripture right here will heal your body if I'll just keep it in my mouth. Oh, you're sick. You're not going to make it. You're not going to overcome this. No. He sent his word and he healed me. He sent his word and he healed me. Well, how many times a day do I have to say that? Who cares how many times you have to say it? Just you say it until the victory is manifest. You don't say it till you get the victory. You've got the victory. You say it till the victory is manifest. Hallelujah. So whatever's been said must be so. See, God's principle of words is this. I said and it was. I say and it is. Whatever the word says already is. Whatever the word says, already is. Psalm 89, verse 34. God shows us how he uses his words. He says here, my covenant will I not break, nor alter the thing that has gone out of my lips. One translation says, I won't break my covenant. I won't renege on what crossed my lips. The easy to read version says, I will never change what I said. Now, one of the greatest things that God taught me very early on in my ministry and in my walk with the Lord was the integrity of God's word. The integrity of God's word. And the Lord taught me that many people don't believe that God will keep his word because they tend to look at God just like they look at another person. Well, God says right here, I will never change what I said. I won't renege on what crossed my lips. I won't do that. This is how God uses words. Once it's said, it's done. I have told people before. I've told my wife before. Somebody, we would agree to do something, and then something would happen, and whatever the case may be, maybe they wouldn't even hold up their end of the bargain. And I would tell my wife, well, my word's out there. I have to do my part because my word's out there. See, that's integrity. Well, God is a man of integrity. He said, I won't change what I said. Well, he said, I'm the Lord that heals you. He didn't say, I'm the Lord that heals you sometimes. I'm the Lord that'll heal you every now and then. The only condition is that I believe that he's the God that heals me. And he won't change what he said. He said, now this goes both ways. Not only will he not change what he said in regards to being the God that heals us, he also won't change what he said in regards to we have to call those things that be not as though they were. God will not change that because he said that. Romans chapter 4 says, God calleth those things that be not as though they were. And one translation says that Abraham became like God in that he called those things that were not as though they were. So we don't know what exactly Abraham said, but we know the condition he found himself in. I know that for 25 years, God made promise to Abram and said, I'm going to multiply your seed. And 74 years later, there was still no child. There was Hagar, but there wasn't the promised child. And God said, all right, now here's what I'm going to do. Your name will not be Abram anymore. It's going to be Abraham. It's going to be the father of a multitude. And he said, I will do what I said. Now, we don't know what Abraham exactly said, but something happened there that caused him to begin to call those things that be not as though they were. Some people just break it down simply that everywhere Abraham went, he was calling himself father of many nations. Well, I understand that, but to call something denotes an intentionality to it. He was doing something intentionally. You know, if you have a dog and you go out in your backyard and you want the dog to come in, you got to call the dog. You may go out there and you don't even see the dog in the backyard. But you don't go up to somebody and go, I don't have a dog. Nope, I don't have a dog. You've got a dog, you just need to call him. If you want the dog, call the dog. You're calling those things that be not as though they were. See, people utilize this principle every day. And they don't think about it. They don't think about what they're doing. My mother used to step out on the front porch of our home and she would call me. Yeah, that was back in the day when moms stepped out on the front porch and yelled for their kids. You know, nice way to say is they called for us. She was yelling. But anyway, hallelujah. And she'd call my name. Well, wherever I was, I knew to get home. Why was she calling for me? She couldn't see me. But she still called for me. And wouldn't you know it, I showed up. Because I knew when she called for me, I need to show up. Now, I know people will say, well, you know, but Pastor, that's just a very elementary example. I understand. But she was working the principle. Everything that is in the spirit, the natural is a type of it. When I call those things that be not as though they were, if someone called me tomorrow and said, are you coming over tomorrow? And I said, yes, I'm coming over there tomorrow. They would get off the phone and say, Pastor's coming tomorrow. Well, how do they know I'm coming tomorrow? Well, number one, I said I was coming tomorrow. But now they're calling what isn't like it is. I'm not there. They can't see me. If I'm supposed to be there at 9 o'clock and someone comes in at a quarter to 9 or 8:20 or 8:30, somewhere around there, they say, is Pastor here yet? They'd say, no, but he's on his way. They don't know I'm on my way. But based on what I said, they're calling those things that be not as though they were, because I said it. Well, if we'll put that much trust in a natural person's word, how much more trust can we put in what God said? So I may not see it, but I'm calling it like it is. Hallelujah. If it comes from God, it's a spiritual law. It will happen. It's a law. It can't fail. Now, this is why you can't afford to be moved by your past experience or someone else's experience. Experience is not the best teacher. The Word of God's the best teacher. You understand? Because there are people that have never seen anybody healed. And if you talk to them about what you're believing God for, the only thing they have to draw on is what they've seen. They've never seen anybody healed. So they're not going to be able to help you. They might hurt you. I can't go by my experience. Listen, I have laid hands on people, and those people have died. I went to one man's house and wanted to pray for him. His wife came to the church here. He had cancer. And his wife wanted me to come pray for him. And I went over and you know, I wanted to pray for him. But it's evident he didn't want me to pray for him. He didn't have a lick of faith. Well, I mean, I understood that. He wasn't saved. He wasn't born again. But we made sure he was right with the Lord. Praise God. Amen. You know, he died. Well, he died because he didn't know it was God's will to heal him. Now, his wife knew it was God's will to heal her. She knew it was God's will to heal her body. She knew that. But yet she died. She died of a heart attack. Well, that doesn't make either one of them bad people. You understand? I'm just saying, I have prayed for people, and we know it's God's will for everyone to be healed. And I've seen that person has died. That experience doesn't stop me from laying hands on somebody else. Because faith is a very personal thing. As you have believed. You understand? So you can see, you can know somebody very close to you that died sick and they appeared to have faith, or they appeared to believe God or whatever. We're not basing it based on them. We're basing this on you. What do you believe God will do? What do you say God will do for you? Well, when God says something, it's a spiritual law. It will happen. Now, for many, that's a change in thought. Well, you know, I know God can. No, it's a spiritual law. It's impossible for it not to happen. And sometimes you got to remind the devil of that. Because he'll try to ramp up the pressure. Well, if you were healed, you'd feel better. Listen, devil, it's a spiritual law. It can't fail. God said it, I'm healed. Yeah, but you don't feel any better. Well, I'm not going to discuss that with you. I'm healed in Jesus' name. You don't sit around and discuss things with liars. That's just the way it is. You just don't. And the Bible says the devil is a liar and the father of it. And so if he's telling you you're not well, liar, he's lying. Yeah, but see, the enemy can only base what he says on how you look and how you say you feel. All right? He'll look at the situation. He'll see the doctor's report, and he'll start working on that. And he'll remind you of that. Oh, the doctor said he had this. That's incurable. The doctor said there's 6 months. The doctor said he's never seen this get any better. The doctor said. Now, see, here's where Isaiah comes in. Whose report are you going to believe? This is what can't lie. We know the devil can lie. Because Jesus said he was a liar. We know that symptoms are changeable. We know that, listen, this is so important. If you could get sick, you can get well. Because that's the law of reciprocals. If I've told people over the years, they say, Pastor, it's so bad. I said, praise God, then it can get good. Because if it can get bad, it can get good. Now, I know that's not real good English, but if it went bad, it can go good. Why? Because James said two things. He said, you put a bit in a horse's mouth, and notice what he said. He said, you turn the horse around with his mouth. So he said, the ship, though it's great and it's big, it's turned with a very small helm, very small rudder, wherever the governor or the captain wants it to go. Well, the horse is are those small things in our life. They can be stopped real quick and turned real quick. But then there are bigger things in your life that the ship represents. It takes some time to turn a ship. You understand? I got Brother Ron here as office assistant, and he was in the Marine Corps for 8 years and did some travel on Navy ships. And I'm sure he would agree with this. You know, there's not like a brake pedal on that ship. When you get ready to turn, you just hit it and turn, make a U-turn. It takes miles to turn that ship. Why? It has to be done in increments. It's a big vessel, right? You can be dealing with something large. Well, listen. The moment you started calling what isn't as though it was, the ship started turning. And you may not even see on your map, it may not even look like you've made any course correction at all, but it's turned. Why has it turned? The Bible says it would. See? Now, I've had people say, that's all you ever say because the Bible says. Right, it's what the Bible says. So we're going with what the Word of God says. Jeremiah said this. He said, is not my word, the Word of God, like a hammer, and it breaks in pieces the rock. My word is like a hammer. It breaks in pieces the rock. Now, here's the issue. I have done my fair share of work with sledgehammers and whatnot over the years. And there are times that you're breaking something with a sledgehammer, breaking a wall or breaking rock. And when you hit it the first time, there's no evidence that that thing's breaking. But here's what I know. The integrity of that rock was compromised because of the force of the blow. And you may hit it two or three times or four times or five times, but eventually that thing's going to come apart. Because the pressure of the word is too great for the circumstance to stand up under. It will have to give. That sickness in your body will have to give. It will have to give place to the word. It'll have to give place to healing. Hallelujah. In John 4, we'll try to wrap this up with this. We'll try. Well, we will. Hallelujah. When our grandson was born, and when he was born, he was actually born in January, and he was not supposed to be due till, I believe, March. And so he was about 2.5 months premature, 3 months premature. And just a small little guy, probably not about as big as my Bible, maybe. And just, you know, a couple pounds, not very big. And, you know, they were saying there were some issues that he was having. And I was coming back from the prison where I minister on Thursday nights. And my wife had sent me a text. Now, he wasn't supposed to show up till I got back. But he's like his pawpaw, he's early everywhere. And so he showed up early. And I had a text from my wife with the picture, said, this is your new grandson. Praise God. Well, I got on the phone with her, and she told me, well, you know, this is what they're saying. And it was a myriad of issues. I mean, he needed to gain weight. His breathing needed to change. A lot of things that they were talking about. Well, I got off the phone after she told me these things. I just began to pray in the Holy Spirit. Well, I knew after a while of praying in the Holy Spirit, I just felt a note of victory. And I knew we've got this. You know, we've won. And while I got there, and to make a long story short, I'm trying to synopsize this as quick as I can. We got there, and of course, you know, it's my son and my daughter-in-law's first child. I mean, wonderful parents they are. But first baby, you know, concern, the baby's up in the ICU. I mean, not in the room and then go, you know, that's where he's got to stay. And he's going to be there for weeks. And so anyway, everybody was there. And she comes from a family of believers, thank God. And everybody was leaving. And I remember walking by her. And I just leaned over and I kissed her on the top of the head. And I said, now, Rebecca, you may not understand all of this. I said, but I'm telling you, I got a note of victory. We got this. It's going to be okay. Now, everybody, my wife had started calling him immediately Mighty Griffin. He's Mighty Griffin because they tried to say how weak he was. No, he's mighty. He's mighty. And the Lord took me to the scripture in Isaiah where it says there's three things on the earth that are exceeding small, but yet they're exceeding wise. Amen. And so I took that and I said, Lord, if they're exceeding small and exceeding wise, then he can be exceeding small and still be mighty. So I took that scripture and began to declare it over him. Well, here's the point. We begin to ask, what needs to happen? Well, he needs to gain weight. So I went and found in the scriptures and I started calling him fat and flourishing. He's fat and flourishing. He's heavy. He's weighty with the goodness of God. Fat and flourishing. Well, he started gaining weight. Now, I'm not putting all the credit on me. I'm just telling you, this is what we did. And every time somebody would say he needs to gain weight, we'd just call for more weight. And then it went on, and, you know, he got out of the hospital, and they took him to the doctor, and the doctor began to say, you know, there's this heart issue, and we're going to maybe have to do this and have to do that. Well, I went over to the book of Jeremiah, where it says God said concerning this, he said, I will bring it health and cure. I will bring it health and cure. Well, that's not just better feeling. That's cured. And so I begin to call for that. We begin to call for that. And the last time he was at the doctor, they couldn't find any problems. Well, you know, that was calling those things that be not. I knew if it could go bad, it could get good. It's just a matter of what I say. My mouth is turning this ship, turning this horse. Now, here's my point. It took some time to turn that. But once you start turning, keep turning. Don't revert back over into the old mindset, because here's what happens. Even though it's turning towards good, if you stop, it'll start turning back the other way. Not by default, but because you turn the rudder that way. Hallelujah. Now, John chapter 4 and verse 46, we'll read these verses and be done here. So Jesus came again to Cana of Galilee, where he made the water wine. And there was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. When he heard that Jesus was come out of Judea into Galilee, he went unto him and besought him that he would come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. Then Jesus said, except you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. In other words, you won't believe in me unless you see signs and wonders. And the nobleman said, sir, come down, unless my child dies. Jesus said to him, go your way, your son lives. And the man believed the word that Jesus... Now notice, the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. And as he was now going down, his servants met him and told him, your son lives. Then inquired he of them of the hour that he began to amend. They said, yesterday, at the seventh hour, the fever left him. So the father knew that it was at the same hour in the which Jesus said unto him, your son liveth, and himself believed, and his whole house. So Jesus said this at the seventh hour, or 1 p.m. in the afternoon. And notice, the moment Jesus said this, the boy started getting better. He wasn't instantaneously healed, but notice what it says. It says, when did he begin to amend? When did he start getting better? Yesterday at 1 o'clock. And he remembered, hey, that's when Jesus said, your son is well. Amen. And people will say, well, this is, you know, that was Jesus. Well, this is more than just Jesus said it. It's the way God uses words. Jesus said he was healed, and it was so. He said it, and the man saw it. What you're saying, you're going to see. Those watching online, those in this room, you're talking and you're saying that you're the healed of the Lord. You're saying and you're declaring that your body is free of disease and sickness and ailments. You will see that in the name of Jesus. Why? Because it's the Word of God. Because it's the Word of God. Whatever the world is buying into, whatever religion's buying into, we just need to not buy into it. There's a gentleman that comes to our church here, one of our ushers, and it's such a wonderful thing. God has done so much for him, and he had no cartilage in his knees, and it was bone on bone, and he was getting cortisone shots in his knees every so often to help with the pain. And he was standing in the back one morning, Sunday morning, and the Holy Spirit was moving very beautifully here. And the Lord said to him, he said, "Steve, run." Well, when you're in that much pain, you know, well, he took off running. And he said, "Pastor, when I took off running, it was like rubber bands were snapping in my knees. And by the time I got to the front, I had no pain." And he was jumping and shouting. People couldn't figure out what he was jumping. I knew he was jumping and running. Well, he went back to the doctor because it was time for the shot. And he went back to the doctor, and he was standing there, and the nurse came in, and she said, "Steve, you don't need these shots anymore." And he said, "Okay." She said, "Come here, let me show you something." And every time he would go in, they would x-ray those knees. And she said, "You see this?" And it was this layer of white substance in his knees. And she said, "That's cartilage." But three weeks before that, he didn't have any cartilage. But every time we would talk about it, he would talk about how his knees were healed. He would talk about how well he was. He would go in there taking shots and be getting the shot, talking about how healed he was. Well, God produced that cartilage. Well, he also had an issue, and it ran in his family. He would get these melanomas on his head. He's, you know, the shingles are gone up top the roof here. And he would get these melanomas on his head. And him and his wife have been married for a number of years. And she said, it has been that way his whole life. Not just recently. He's never been without those. But he's without them now. Because the last one, notice this, the last one fell off 2 weeks ago. Well, you know what he's been declaring? I'm a cancer-free zone. I am a cancer-free zone. See, it's not just a positive confession. When you start saying these things, whatever it is, and I don't understand the ins and outs of cancer, and I don't pretend to, but I do know it's your body turning against itself. I do know that. Whatever was causing those rogue cells to produce cancer on his head, those melanomas, they corrected themselves and stopped doing it. And notice what died. The cancer died. Not the skin, not Steve, the cancer. And I'm declaring it'll always be that way. Amen. Hallelujah. So say this with me today. Say, "Father, in the name of Jesus, I believe with all my heart that I am the healed of the Lord. So I call myself healed. I call myself well. I call myself whole, and I believe that what I have said is surely going to come to pass in Jesus' name." Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Well, we appreciate everyone being here today, everyone watching online, and we'll be here every Tuesday at 2 p.m. Sharing the Word of God concerning our healing. So until we see you again next time, please remember to keep the switch of faith turned on and build your faith and frame your world by the Word of God. God bless you.